All right. Good morning, church. All right. Man, after that sermon, I think we can go home now. That was so good, Brian. Amen. Amen, bro. So good. So we're continuing this series in 1 Corinthians. And man, you're never going to hear that song the same way now, yeah? Has anybody at least been like putting on your Spotify playlist? Okay, good. Just checking. Such a good song. The idea is this, is that the church of Corinth had this problem of letting rats into their kitchen. They let things from the culture and the world come and dictate how things were happening in the church, and chaos ensued. And man, we're in chapter 7 today, and chapter 7 is going to deal with some very specific rats, if you will. It's going to deal with things pertaining to marriage, sex, singleness, and divorce. Stuff that we're like, whoa, that are heavy, but they're all still really applicable to us today. Now, before we get into it, I have a big disclaimer. And this disclaimer, not a disclaimer is not the right word, just kind of a pastoral sort of banner I want to throw out there is that whenever we engage scripture, especially in this format, and we start talking about what is right and what is wrong and what is sin and what is not sin, we live by this like sort of unwritten code, which is in scripture, which is that there is no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. Amen. So if we're talking about immorality and we talk about sin and stuff like that, if you're coming into this place doing the things we're talking about, we say, welcome, there's grace for you. Amen. So don't feel like as we have these discussions that this is a judgment on you. This is allow the Spirit of God to kind of speak to you about what it might look like to live a more Pono life in Him. Amen. So when we're talking about divorce and all these things, this is normal for our culture. Like we see a lot of people who've just had a wild journey and life hasn't been what you want it to be. And so let me give you a couple things, interactions I've had with God in my journey that might help kind of us how we think about this chapter. COVID happened, 2019, 2020. I remember just praying because as a pastor, what your heart longs for is to see like the church, to see the sheep, the sheepfold of God really flourish, even in times of chaos. And I didn't know what that looked like. And people were staying home and people were getting scared and people were talking about the mark of the beast and all these things were happening. And you're trying to like have some kind of gathering of like guys, what's going on here? Nobody knows what's happening in the world right now. There is, as Bren said, and I think that's the whole point, is there is this fear that drives chaos. And what happens is we pray, oftentimes controlling prayers to try to counteract that chaos. Does that make sense? So here's an example of that. When we were praying in COVID, I was praying like, Lord, I need this. I need you to show me this. I need you to do this with people. I need this here and that here. And I need to know what's happening. I need clarity on this. And I'm asking very specific things. And here's the response I felt the Lord gave me. Grow out your hair. All right. And still to this day, has never been as short as it was pre-COVID. I'm just still growing it out. Although my wife did not receive that word from the Lord. So she battled me on it. And my hair, if you've seen me a couple years ago, like my hair was like down to here. Like it was long. And we compromised. And I said, I'll cut the sides and keep the man bun. And Meg's like, fine. Like whatever, do that. But then I noticed it wasn't just me that gets weird prayers answered from God, like weird answers from Him. I had another pastor friend say the same thing in a time of chaos when he felt like he had something to add prophetically to his community. He's like, nobody's listening and I'm trying to bring order and nobody's listening to me. And God told him the same thing. He said, stop shaving. He's like, okay. Didn't understand what that meant, but he just stopped shaving for a little while. Okay. Thanks, Lord, for that, whatever that means. Another pastor friend, I just heard this one last week, he said this. I said, I've been praying to the Lord about I'm just not hearing from Him directly. And Lord, where are you on this matter? I need this. I need this. I need answers. I need all these very specific things to help me get through life. And the Lord told him, stop setting your alarm in the morning and start setting it at night. Huh? He just felt like a prompting in his spirit, like this is what the Lord is saying. Here's what happens oftentimes with the Lord. When we're seeking very specific answers, I think Brendan kind of shaped that really well. We seek specific answers because we think our ability to have those answers will help us control the outcome and give us some kind of peace that we're looking for. And God oftentimes doesn't give us the answers. He gives us, when it's chaotic, He gives us order. Does that make sense? And the order always starts with, listen to me, be still, know that I am God, and from these things they will flow. What I didn't realize that growing out my hair for 3 years during COVID was actually an exercise in endurance. And it was an exercise for me. And this is actually a biblical thing. There's these Nazarites in the Bible who grew out their hair and they fasted from wine and these things. And this was actually the Lord saying, I want you, as you grow out your hair. And my wife's like, when are you going to cut it? I'm like, I feel like God hasn't given me a green light yet. And she thought I was just like, you know, like just messing with her. I'm like, no, for real. I feel like I'm not supposed to yet. And when the Lord says, babe, you know what I mean? So this is take it to the Lord. Don't take it to me. So long story short, I realized there's something in my heart that God was doing. It was a weird order, but in growing out my hair, the Lord was saying, do something. And then I met Holly, and Holly's like, did you know I came to your church during COVID because of your hair? I was like, okay, praise God. There it is. But that's the answer. My friend with the beard, when he said, stop shaving, the friend with the beard said, as soon as I grew my beard out, people started actually listening to what I had to say. And he has a great big gray beard. He looks like Gandalf, like a Hawaiian Gandalf. It's awesome. But there was something in the order of that that he didn't get a direct answer for what he was looking for, but he got some kind of steps into ordering his life to allow the Lord in. The friend with the alarm clock said this. He said, when I started setting my alarm clock in the nighttime instead of the morning, it told me, go to bed now. And I realized I was so sleep deprived, I couldn't hear the voice of the Lord because my anxiety was keeping me up at night. When I forced myself to go to sleep and get longer rests, it's like the Lord just started speaking to me. It was an order, get your body right, get healthy. And the Lord actually kind of comes in when we order our life around sleep and health and good diet and all these things. The Lord actually speaks to us in that. So all these weird things, I want to give you a vision for what this chapter is going to be. The church at Corinth writes Paul a letter, and they say, we are struggling with chaos. There's chaos happening in our church. We don't know what to do. Paul is not just writing a list of, here's what you do, here's what you do, here's what you do. He's saying, here is godly order to help with the chaos in your church. Does that make sense? And he makes it clear. He says, this is from God. This is my opinion. He's very good at differentiating those two things. So I want to say that out loud because this is how the Lord works. And as we approach this, don't read this as a list of rules that we have to like, okay, must do this, must do this, must do this. Read this as Paul saying, hey, as a godly man who understands scripture and listens to the Spirit, follow this. It's going to bring order to it, to the chaos that is in your church when it comes to the home. So the title of today is this, is order in the home. Part of the problem with the church is not what happens at church, it's what happens when the people in church go home. Amen? That's where a lot of times are the church problems come from. There's disorder in the home, and he's going to speak specifically to these things on sex, marriage, singleness, and divorce, these kinds of things. The things that build the home, the foundations of the home. And so we're going to jump into this in verse 1, and he says this, and if you haven't been coming, we're going to read a lot of passage, if that's okay. If you have a hard Bible, praise God. Open your hard Bible. It's so good for your soul to read large chunks of scripture, not just sort of like little memory verses here and there. Amen? So read big chunks. God gave you literacy as a gift. Use it, men and women of God. Amen. What a blessing. Did you know there are people hundreds of years ago who would have killed to be able to read the Bible? You know what I mean? Like sometimes we take that for granted. So it's not a I have to, it's an I get to in Jesus' name. What a blessing. Chapter 7, verse 1. Now concerning the questions you asked in my letter, in your letter, pause, there's clearly a letter that they wrote to Paul before Paul wrote the letter to the Corinthians back. It's a response letter. We don't have that. We don't know what they asked him, but we can tell by Paul's answers what they likely were asking him. Yes, it is good to abstain from sexual relations. Thanks. When? Why? How? That doesn't help. But, so he said, it's good to restrain from sexual relations, but, huge caveat, there is so much sexual immorality, each man should have his own wife, and each woman should have her own husband. That Greek word for have, literally, it's kind of an idiom for saying taking in sexual intimacy. So to have somebody is to have intimacy with them. So he said, with all the sexual immorality around, here's the clearest way you can think of what healthy sexuality is going to look like. And he addresses the immorality a chapter before. He's saying, here's the best thing. Man, have your wife. Women, have your husband. Simple. The husband should fulfill his wife's needs, and the wife should fulfill her husband's needs. Then it says this, and this is one of those things that might make you riled up in your spirit. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. And so if this makes you feel like this is kind of problematic, Pastor Mark, it is problematic if you don't understand what Paul's talking about. What he's not talking about is authority as in dominion. You have a say over your spouse's body. Traditionally, or I would say almost historically, this has been used for really just pilau practices within a marriage, where husbands saying, your body belongs to me, and you're supposed to be doing this, and you're supposed to be doing this. And it can drive, if you don't read this correctly, it can drive the wrong spirit and drive terrible, toxic behaviors in a marriage. So when he says this, that the wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does, and vice versa, he's going back to Genesis 2, where he says, God created man and said, it is not good for man to be alone. So he gave him a partner, a suitable helper, that the man would leave his mother and father and become joined to his wife and become one in the flesh. Here's the idea. Paul, as a Jewish man, is riffing on this. If we are one in the flesh, is it your flesh or my flesh? It's our flesh, which means I have the obligation, not obligation, I have the kuleana, I get a special privilege of loving your body, and you have the special privilege of loving my body. One thing that's happening, one of the rats in the kitchen, was there's a cultural trend called asceticism. Asceticism was this: abstain from sex, even within marriage, because it makes you more holy. To put away the flesh, it's like you're fasting from your sexual desire, is good for your spirit. Paul's actually saying, like, that's not how this works. This isn't a good thing. So Paul is actually addressing people who are, that's why that verse in verse 1, he's addressing it. Yeah, it's good to abstain from sexual relations, but not in a marriage, right? It's actually not a healthy thing to abstain in a marriage. There were people who thought there was some kind of spiritual elitism if I can, like, withhold our sexuality and still maintain a marriage. This still has, like, ripple effects today. There are still people that live in sexless marriages, and sometimes we can convince ourselves that a sexless marriage is holy in some capacity. And this is something that Paul wants to kind of correct that and be like, don't forget what the Lord gave sex for. And I love how Pastor Rick said that last week, is sometimes we make sex all about all these rules, can't do it here, can't do it there, can't have it with this person, can't have it with that person. The Bible gives a positive vision of sex for husband and wife in marriage. And if there's a positive vision for it, it is a good thing that we glorify God in. I worked with a couple years ago, during COVID actually, that got engaged. And they were fired up. They were ready to go. They were like ready to start this life together and be intimate together. And they're doing their best to contain themselves for marriage. And because of COVID, they couldn't have a wedding. And so they had this like 2-year engagement. And they're like, Pastor Mark, we don't know what to do. We just feel like we should just go and go to the courthouse and get married. And we kind of talked about different options, but that was their decision, so they went to the courthouse and got married. What was interesting was they struggled to have boundaries before they got married, so they kept doing it and kept doing it and kept doing it, while it was not supposed to be what they're doing. But as soon as they got married, it became something that they had a hard time continuing to do. And this is something, it's a phenomenon of human experience, why it is that when it's taboo, we like to do it, but as soon as it's a good thing, we have a hard time doing it, right? This is like the flesh that Paul talks about in Romans 7. The things I want to do, I can't do, and the things that I don't want to do, I keep doing it, right? Sex is a hard thing because most of us have grown up, especially if you grew up in the church, we grew up with this purity culture that says, sex is bad, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. And as soon as people get married, we're like, no, switch the light on, now it's a good thing, now do it, do it, do it, do it, do it. And switching gears is hard. And that purity culture that a lot of us grew up in has actually done damage to how we view sexuality, because it's taught us, it's conditioned us to think us so negatively of sex, or so like dirty, like sex makes us dirty, that we have a hard time expressing it joyfully, peacefully, and wonderfully in marriage. And so if this is you, good news. The Word of God has something to say about that this morning. Amen? So that's the good news. So I just want to say, like, this isn't just unique to their time. Like, having sort of this abstaining in marriage can be a really toxic thing. And he gives some qualifications. There are reasons and ways why people might do it. But the big idea is this, is that when we are tethered together in covenant, my body is now yours. I say to my wife, I have this kuleana to love your body, because we're one in the flesh, and her kuleana is to love my body. So I come to her and I say, my body is yours. And she comes to me and says, my body is yours. And for my wife, she said, your body, Mark, is a wonderland, right? Just kidding. Just kidding. She's never said that in her life. But just seeing if you guys are paying attention. Just kidding. But here's the idea. It's this shared ownership. And the goal is when we have authority, and when it says take care of each other's needs, I don't come to my spouse saying, I have needs, you fulfill them, woman, right? That's not how it works. I come looking to love first and receive love second. How can I love your body, babe? We're one in the flesh. And here's, I say it this way. Sex is a great indicator in marriage. It's not the only intimacy, but it's a great benchmark that there is intimacy. In other words, if every couple has different rhythms, don't feel guilty if you feel like, man, we don't have a lot of sexual like intimacy throughout the week or throughout the months. It feels slow in some seasons. It feels faster in other seasons. Your marriage will navigate that. And there's no right or wrong necessarily. But having a rhythm of some kind is a healthy thing. It shows you that there's healthy intimacy. Because sex is this crazy thing where it is the best way you can possibly love another human's body is in marriage. And that's why marriage is such an important prerequisite of that. Because if I'm called to love you with my whole life, I want to love your body, only your body, the way that you've loved me, the way the Lord's loved me. So it's a channeling of love. And it's never I come to get and get and get. If you're in a marriage where it just seems like, oh, I have needs, and look, the Bible says you're supposed to fill my needs, right? You're already missed it. Because it's not your having authority doesn't mean you have dominion. It means you have the first privilege of offering yourself up to love the other person. It's submission. Submit to each other's body, really. It might be a better way to say that. But this is the idea, is that Paul wants us to understand really quickly that intimacy is a great thing, and it's an important thing in marriage. This isn't something we just throw aside. He goes on to say this in verse 5, do not deceive each other of sexual relations. Do not deprive each other of sexual relations unless you both agree to refrain from sexual intimacy for a limited time so you can give yourselves more completely to prayer. The caveat here is, things happen. Sometimes to me, asking my wife, how can I love your body, right? When she just had twins and she was pregnant for 9 months and felt like this big, right? Isn't going to be me asking her, hey, I have needs. Can you fill my needs? She's like pumping milk, like holding baby. She's like looking at me and she's like, really? You're coming to me asking for stuff when I'm literally getting the life sucked out of me right now, my body, right? So there's this thing where we have to be aware to love my wife and to love her body well. Sometimes we'll say, in this moment, sex isn't the right thing. But asking her, babe, how do I love you right now? And not looking to receive, but looking to give first. So when it says don't deprive each other of sexual relations, he's talking in this like religious asceticism of, you know, don't think your soul high above the other person. That, hey, my body, I'm deciding to fast from sex, you know, because I think it's holy and it's good for me. And then your partner's like, wait a minute, we joined our lives together. It's not just your say, right? There is an equal ownership of sexual intimacy. So then he goes on to say this. Oh, and I would just say this too. With things like that, with physical limitations and just age, and there's no guilt or shame if you feel like you're not connecting as much or as you want to or you should. There's so much grace over that. And there's so many other ways in marriage to be intimate. And that's one thing I always encourage people. If they feel like they're struggling with that in marriage, I just be like, man, there's 100 ways you can be intimate and connect on an emotional, spiritual levels that don't involve sex. But sex should be there present in some kind of rhythm. So that being said, afterward, come together after you've been fasting and praying, right? So we're not doing it for this season because we're focusing on the Lord. Satan won't be able to tempt you because of your lack of self-control. I say this as a concession, not as a command. But I wish everyone were single, just as I am. And Paul starts like kind of bending it sideways. He's like, it's great, be intimate, be married, have married fun. And then he's like, but I wish everybody was single like me. And you're like, huh? Where is this coming from? Yet each person has a special gift from God of one kind or another. This is a really important word when we talk about singleness and marriage. Gift. Your marriage is not a right, it's a gift. Singleness is not a default, it's a gift. Does that make sense? What do you do with a gift? You use it, you steward it, you have fun with it, you enjoy the full capacity of that gift. So when Paul is calling, he's insinuating here that both singleness, he's like, be single like me, it's the dream. Or if you're married, both of them are a gift. And that's the first point in your notes. Marriage and singleness are both gifts from God. As a church, not necessarily our church, but the church at large, we've done a really bad job at honoring singleness as a gift. And we've looked at it, generally speaking, as this thing that we have to cure in you. That if you're single, there's something wrong with you. Why are you still single? And I'm guilty of that too. I do it all the time. Like, you're 35 and you're wonderful, you're smart, you're beautiful. Why aren't you married, right? But we don't recognize that there's something working in the spirits of people in their singleness, that God has this really cool connection with them that's unique and it's worth stewarding. And Paul's going to start pulling that apart and say, this is why I love being single, right? So all the bachelors in the house can like celebrate today. Like, yeah, Paul's on our team. Check out verse 8. To the unmarried and the widows, I say that it is good for them to remain single as I am. Do as I do. Just stay single. Save the drama for your mama. But if they cannot exercise self-control, they should marry. For it is better to marry than to burn with passion. Not burn in hell with passion. My very legalistic background, like the high school I went to growing up, they told me that this is like, you will burn. Like passion, sexual desire will make you burn in hell, right? He's saying burn with passion, meaning like it just, the passion for romance, the passion for love and intimacy, sexual intimacy will burn in you. So he says that's going to have to be fulfilled. If that's you, get married. That's the whole point of marriage, is to really make an avenue to love somebody that well in a covenant. So he's saying this. Oh, to the married, I give this charge. Not I, but the Lord. The wife should not separate from her husband, but if she does, she should remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband, and the husband should not divorce his wife. When he says this, it's not me, but it's the Lord. He's actually referencing Jesus. You can look it up in Matthew 19. The Pharisees come to Jesus and they said, can we divorce our wife for any reason? Now, this is important. For First Temple Judaism, there's two streams of thought going on when it comes to divorce. First stream was legalistic. You can never divorce your spouse, your wife, unless there was some kind of sexual infidelity. Another stream came in and they said, no. If they do anything that makes them unclean, you can divorce them. So if a woman wears her hair down in public, if a woman eats a shellfish, then you can divorce her. So think about a group of men, religious leaders, coming to Jesus saying, is it true that we can divorce our wife for any reason? What are they looking for? They're looking for an answer to get out of their marriages. Can we throw our spouses to the side for little things they do wrong? Is basically what they're asking. And Jesus' response is beautiful. I love how he puts it. And he just says, like, first of all, don't you realize? He kind of answers, is like, have you guys even read the scripture? Have you forgotten why God created marriage? This is a beautiful and whole and healthy thing. And he says this is, you know it's not good for man to be alone, but I tell you this, because you're going to keep prying, is my summary, here's two reasons. Jesus gives two reasons that divorce should be okay. Number one, there's adultery. Number one, there's adultery. And then number two, the other spouse leaves. You did your best, but the other spouse decided to leave you. It says, in those moments, you can't fight for someone who doesn't want to be there. What Paul's going to do is he's going to add a third dynamic in a little bit. And he's going to say, there's actually another kind of reason where divorce becomes legitimate. But always, this is always the case, and Paul will hit this, that God's value, first and foremost, is that we would be reconciled to our spouse forever. That this would be a lifelong covenant. That's the dream. Life happens, things happen, but the standard and the goal should always be, I'm going to be with this person forever. Amen? So that being said, verse 11, when he says, but if she does, she should remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband, and the husband should not divorce his wife. What's wild about this is culturally at the time, Jewish men had no spiritual authority unmarried. So for Paul to tell people they should remain unmarried, especially for a woman whose life like counted on the income of a man, these are really radical things that Paul's saying. And here's one way to think about it. If you are single, when Paul makes a strong case for singleness and saying this is a gift from God, for Jewish thinkers, there's actually an old rabbinic tradition that rabbis would say there's seven types of Jews that aren't going to heaven. And they had these lists. If you're this kind of Jew, you're not going to heaven. It's almost like the seven deadly sins. The number one on the list is unmarried Jews. Unmarried Jewish men will not go to heaven. So they had such a high value for marriage, That even, in fact, the Sanhedrin, the highest religious council of the Jews, you had to be married to be on the Sanhedrin. So for Paul, we actually don't know. Some people debate whether he was on the Sanhedrin or not. It seems like he was. But in this passage, he's not currently married. So we're like, did he divorce? Did he? What happened? We don't know. There's no record of it. There's just speculation. But I want to be this really clear to this. Sometimes we do this with singleness. We say, oh no, God said Genesis 2, it is not good for man to be alone. Then God made a helper. The Hebrew word is ezer, a suitable helper to fulfill God's mission in his life, and they will partner together, be one in the flesh, and do what the Lord asked them to, glorify God with their life and their marriage. What happens is like, well, if I'm single, it's not good that I'm alone, right? Here's the wild thing. When Jesus came and he said, I'm sending you a helper, in the Hebrew translation of the Greek, guess what that word helper is? An ezer. The Holy Spirit will not allow you to be alone anymore. So even if you're single, you're not alone. Amen? Because of the presence of God. So if you feel lonely being single, that's a normal feeling to have. Just know this, that there is a purpose for your singleness and you're not alone in the mission because the God of all creation has sent a helper for you. Amen? So this is kind of how we see this, how we read Genesis 2 in the New Covenant. 1 Corinthians 7 goes on, now I will speak to the rest of you, though I don't have direct command from the Lord here. He's like, this is my opinion. If a fellow believer has a wife who is not a believer and she is willing to continue living with him, he must not leave her. Paul's actually advocating for unequaled yokeness, and there's a reason. Hold on. And if a believing woman has a husband who's not a believer and he's willing to continue living with her, she must not leave him. Why? Verse 14. For the believing wife brings holiness, or your version might say sanctifies the marriage, and the believing husband brings holiness to his marriage. Otherwise, your children would not be holy. Now they are holy. Here's what he's not saying. That if there's a married couple, one's a believer, one's not, that your faith will save the other person for eternity. It's not a saving faith. What he's saying is this. There is a holiness that you carry as a son or a daughter of God. And that holiness you carry will not be able to, or be contained to a point where they can't experience the loving reach of God. Does that make sense? One way we think about holiness in the Bible is the sun. God is holy. The closer you get to the sun, the more you're going to burn up, right? This is the holiness of God. We can only get so far to the holiness of God without being overwhelmed by it. But as that radiance of God's holiness by faith in Christ comes out of us, people in our proximity, the blessings of our life, the love that's channeled into us from God will be channeled to those in our proximity. This is why he calls us a light. Amen? You have a light that shines and people around you see it and feel it and experience it. He's saying this. Here's a short way to say it. By faith in Christ, you've become sons and daughters of the Most High God from the Gospel of John. If I am a child of God and God loves me and I'm married, even if they're not believers, to love me well, wouldn't God have to love my family? Yes. So there's sanctification in my home because of my faith. Paul's pointing out a spiritual truth that goes beyond the wisdom of, well, can we make this work if we don't have the same, you know, belief system? I saw this at work this week. Can I share a story? I was at this ministry with a friend, and we're talking to Gen Zs about angels and demons, like the supernatural view of Scripture. I didn't realize most of the young adults in the room were non-believers. I didn't know that until we kind of met into smaller groups. So I'm meeting with a guy, and he's in the sciences at UH, and he was telling me, and he was just kind of like very confidently like, no, I hear what you're saying, but everything supernatural can be described by neurons and chemical reactions in your brain and hallucinations that happen, and these are all very explainable things. So I have a hard time believing in the supernatural because I think we can explain it all with science. So I'm like, oh, those are really good thoughts. And I was like, why are you here? Like, for real, like, why? What made you come to this? And he said, well, I've been dating my girlfriend, and she's come to believe in Jesus. And since she came to believe in Jesus, I've noticed I've become a lot more open to understanding things and trying to, like, just at least come and listen and get new ideas. Huh. So you're telling me the faith of your girlfriend is now shaking up the foundation of your atheism, right? There is a sanctity that happens in proximity to the saints. When you get around the saints, you feel who they worship. Does that make sense? And they're not married, they're just dating, right? And part of me wants to stomp over to her and be like, how dare you date someone who doesn't know the Lord, right? But at the same time, I'm like, I'm listening to Paul, and Paul's like, bro, like, get this girl saved. Like, get, here's what, here's a great quote, right? A great quote from N.T. Wright. He says this: Paul believed that holiness could be more powerful than uncleanness. So in other words, a normal reaction for Christians at this time, would be, I'm a Christian now. I've met Jesus. Oh, you're not a believer? Okay, you're unclean to me. We should cut you off because this isn't going to work out. And there's this kind of high maka-maka thing, like we're above them, we're condescending. And N.T. Wright is saying, Paul believed that holiness could be more powerful than uncleanness. The relationship would not need to be damaging for the Christian. The unbelieving partner would be regularly within reach of God's love. So the Christian spouse ought not initiate a split. Paul is saying something radical here. You, Christian, are a beautiful light of the Most High God. Your marriage feels it whether you know it or not. If you're married to an unbelieving spouse, don't think that God's love is not channeling through them or that God has no plan to reach them through you. And now this isn't to say we should date people who are believers, who aren't believers, so that we can save them. This is to say that if you find yourself in a relationship where there's a difference of faith, see it through the spiritual lens, that they are sanctified by your faith. And if that sounds like a weird thing, it's in the scripture all the time. Think about Laban's household. When Laban told Jacob, he's like, bro, I'm so glad you came to my household because you've sanctified our whole family. You've brought the holiness of God to us. And then you think about Potiphar and Potiphar's house with Joseph, who's the same thing. Think about Sodom and Gomorrah. With Sodom and Gomorrah, God's like, I'm going to wipe this place out, but I need you to find 50 people that are righteous. Can't find them. How about 40? How about 10? We'll stick with 10, okay? 10 righteous. God's like, fine, 10 righteous people, I'll spare this whole city. But they couldn't do it. And you know the story. Here's the point. The righteous 10 righteous people have the power to sanctify an entire city. You tracking? In the kingdom of God, one righteous spouse has the power to sanctify an entire family. Paul's riffing on this. Like, he's like, don't ever mistake your powerful witness within your marriage. I'm going to call it out because I've seen this a lot. When you have an unbelieving and a believing spouse, oftentimes what happens is the believing spouse will succumb to the unbelieving spouse's wishes and desires, because they want the marriage to work more than they want to please God. And Paul is saying, don't get your priorities mixed up. First and foremost, you belong to the Lord. Be the best believer you possibly can be in your marriage and watch him cook, right? That's what's happening. It's like, let God do his thing. And two things are going to happen. One, your unbelieving spouse is going to come and understand the love of God in due time, or they're going to leave. And he says, bye, Felicia. That's what Paul says. It's in the next verse. Here's the point. Number two in your notes. Christians, you light up your homes. Amen? We lose the order that God is calling, especially to the chaos of like marriage and sexuality in our culture, if we stop believing that every hale is a hale pule. Every house is a church. Every Christian in their home can light that home up. And so don't underestimate the power of God reaching across to unbelievers, even within a family. And I just want to say this pastorally too, because I've seen this over the years. I can see the grief of people coming to church, knowing that their best friend, their spouse, their lover doesn't know God. And I'm here at church and there's this empty seat next to me that's reminding me that they're not here and that they don't believe. And I want to encourage you that I've seen it personally, but I believe what the word is saying is even more true. That your witness in the family, even though it might feel like you're fighting a wall or fighting an upward battle, your witness in the family is far more powerful than their stubbornness or unbelief. Amen? The power of God in you through love is far more powerful than their stubborn unbelief. And so if you have a husband who likes to stay home and watch football, right? And that's his excuse, but he really doesn't know if he believes. Keep loving him as Christ loved the church. because what's going to happen is something's going to shift in him. And like I saw with this kid this last week, his voice was so certain. He's like, yes, I don't believe in these things. I don't believe in science. Science can answer everything. But I could feel in his spirit the foundations were being shaken by the love of his girlfriend and her relationship to the Lord. Don't overestimate that. Amen. So granted, I want to say this last thought on this point is that Paul's talking to like the Holy Spirit was just doing crazy stuff. People were coming in hordes to receive Jesus. And so what happened is people who were already married, one spouse would come to know Jesus, one wouldn't. So it was almost like they already had a marriage covenant, but now they're in this predicament. For us, we all, whatever life happens and we end up in different faith places in a marriage, the goal is always the same, is to glorify God in your marriage. And as you do that, you'll see things change. But there's also this wisdom of, if you're going to be married or looking for a spouse, don't look for a spouse who doesn't know Jesus. It'll cause more problems than not. And that's actually, Paul will go on to say that. But point is this, you light up a home, Christian. 15 says this, if the husband or the wife who isn't a believer, and again, Paul's getting kind of nitty gritty here, but listen to the heart and the order he's giving. If the husband or wife who isn't a believer insists on leaving, by Felicia, right? In such cases, the believing husband or wife is no longer bound to the other, for God has called you to live in peace. If you have someone you're married to and they're like, your faith doesn't make sense to me, I want out because I'm not on board with that, it's hard. It's a grievous thing. But he's like, that's okay, because your duty is first and foremost to him before it is to your marriage. In such cases, the believing husband or wife is no longer bound to the other. But check what he says here. 16, don't you wives realize that your husbands might be saved because of you? And don't your husbands realize that your wives might be saved because of you? Paul's getting like, this is a really weird way to think about marriage. Paul's thinking like an evangelist in the context of marriage. He's like, what a glorious thing that you've attached your life to someone who doesn't know Jesus. Don't you think that Jesus might use you to reach them? And they're like, whoa, I'm not an evangelist to my spouse. We're just supposed to, you know, get along and love each other and, you know, do married things together. But Paul has a kingdom vision for it. 17, he says, each of you should continue to live in whatever situation the Lord has placed you and remain as you were when God first called you. So he's saying, man, if God called you and you were already married and now you find yourself married to an unbeliever, don't leave it. If you're already there, just be who God called you to be in your current situation. If you were single and God called you, stay single. If you were married, stay married. This is my rule for all the churches. So number three is this, live in the gift you are in. Singleness is a gift. And again, we're going to get there because he's going to talk about why it's a gift. Live in the gift you are in. The dysfunction we have is when married people want to live in the gift of singleness and when single people want to live in the gift of marriage. Amen? If you're single, act like you're single. If you're married, act like you're married. Simple, yeah? If you're not married yet, don't act like you're married. And if you are married, don't act like you're single, right? You get the point. But this idea is what's happening is you have this like celibacy within marriages, and Paul's like, no, that's what single people do. Don't so hold yourself off from marriage. That's not what you do. You guys love each other, right? Go love on your wife. Get all up on her. Like, make things happen. Be intimate. And the opposite is true, too. There's single people. The temptation is to live as if I'm married, even though I'm not married. Paul's like, live in the gift you are in. If you are single, recognize that as a gift. And here's how he starts pulling that apart. Verse 25, he says, now regarding your question about the young women who are not yet married, your version might say the virgins. There's this debate over whether he's talking about young women in general or women who are engaged. It might say betrothed, your versions. But he says, I do not have a command from the Lord for them. He's like, all I got is my own wisdom. But the Lord is in his mercy has given me wisdom that can be trusted, and I'll share this with you. Because of the present crisis, I think it's best to remain as you are. What is he saying? He's telling young women, do not get married, remain single because of what's happening in the world. This is a very unique cultural thing Paul is talking to this church, because Paul has seen persecution, he's seen persecution on the rise, and what he's the kind of basic understanding is this. if you're going to be persecuted for your faith, why would you get married and have kids and bring them into that persecution? That's really what he's saying. He's a very pragmatic thinker, Paul is. So this isn't just, again, we don't take this as just like doctoral rules, right? Like, these are just wisdom. This is Paul, and he said that himself. He's like, this isn't a command, it's just wisdom. Remain as you are. If you have a wife, don't seek to end the marriage. Keep being married. If you do not have a wife, do not seek to be married. But if you do get married, it's not a sin. And if a young woman gets married, it's not a sin. However, those who get married in this time will have troubles, and I'm trying to spare you those problems. Here's what, again, Paul's not saying. He's not saying, if you get married, you're going to have marriage problems. You don't want marriage problems. Any one of us who are married know that the perks and benefits and beauty of being married is worth enduring the marriage problems. Amen? Paul's not saying you're going to have marriage problems. He's saying you're going to have like straight up persecution. Your life could be on the line. That's why he's so adamant about this. He's like, really think twice about getting married, because what's coming for the church is going to be nuts. So this is a very unique context for that. But I want to kind of shift for a second and ask this question. Because one thing that Paul does not answer for us here is how. How, Paul, do I live like a good married husband or a wife? What does it look like to foster intimacy? Because he kind of makes it sound plain, yeah? Like, oh, just go and have sexual relations and that's it. And for some of us, sex is complicated. And sex brings up things from our past and we have baggage attached to it. And it's a fearful thing for many and it's a painful thing for many. This is real. So there's something, there's a responsibility in marriage to foster intimacy, primarily through sex, but through all sorts of things. And I found this really helpful. There's a study of 70,000 happily married couples who've been married for over 30, 40 years, who have high satisfaction in their marriage, high satisfaction for sex, and they were asked these questions. What has been the deal breaker for you in your marriage? What has been that thing that made intimacy flourish? And five big things from 70,000 couples, five big things popped out. You guys want that wisdom? You'll have to join us next week for, just kidding. Here it is. Number one, give compliments. Married, happily married couples who have happy sex give lots of compliments. How does Jesus say it? That out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. If you have love in your heart and it's not coming out through your mouth, the other person will not know the love that you carry for them, end of the day. And you can serve them and do everything behind the scenes and be like, look at me, don't you see how I love you in all these other ways? Say something. God gave you one tongue, use them. You know what I mean? And there's plenty of applications to that one, but you know what I'm saying. Number two, surprise. This is it. It's, guys, we're talking about sex in church. It's going to be good. Number two, surprise with gifts. Really important. Surprise with gifts. Not to be expensive, but thoughtful. Just pop up like, hey, I know you like this kind of peanut butter more than the cheap one I usually buy. So I splurged a little bit. I bought you the nice peanut butter. Aww. Easy kind. My wife is so easy like with that. It's just, oh, the simplest things. But surprise them. Just be thoughtful. Be like spontaneous and thoughtful. These things, all the healthiest, happiest couples in marriage have that element. Number three is cuddle. Cuddlers make marriage work. Amen? If you're not a cuddler, if you're just stiff by nature, God bless you. We're going to pray that out of you. We're going to pray that stiffness right out of you so that you might cuddle as God called you to cuddle. Here's a fun fact. The opposite, those who don't cuddle, only 4% of marriages, of that 70,000, 4% of couples who don't cuddle have a healthy sex life. Here's the opposite of that. 96% of couples who don't cuddle don't have a healthy sex life. Isn't that interesting? So cuddling's really important. And there's all sorts of probably psychology behind that, that there's something about the intimacy and the connecting, the emotional connecting that happens that will make way for these things. Number four is weekly dates, making time for intimacy to flourish. It's busy. Busyness is always going to be our battle. And if we can fight that busyness and let intimacy flourish, it's going to be a huge thing. Last one is public and intentional affection. So showing everybody else how I love, like intentional affection, like longer kisses, more intentional, like kisses for no reason, hugging, just being present and physical in public. It shapes your body out of like friend zone mode where you just hug them and kiss them and you're like, oh, that's right. Like, this is my spouse, right? Which is, if you've been married long enough, you know exactly what I mean. Sometimes you just get into like partner mode and you just need to get out of that again. So long story short, these are just five everyday things you can do just to help foster intimacy in your marriage. And Paul goes on, he finishes the letter like this. Let me say this, dear brothers and sisters, verse 29. The time remains short. He's thinking Jesus is coming back soon, which is good. He has this imminency. So he says, from now on, those with wives should not focus on their marriage. Those who weep or rejoice or who buy things who do not should not be absorbed by their weeping or their joy or their possessions. Those who use things of this world should not become attached to them. For this world as we know it will soon pass away. This is a punch to the gut for most of us, especially the romantics in the house. Your marriage will pass away with this earth. And not to say that your relationship with your spouse isn't eternal. That is. But what he's saying is don't neglect what's happening all around us. That this world is coming to a close. The kingdom of God is coming. Jesus is going to return. Don't spend your whole life investing in things here that are going to end here. Don't be so absorbed in them is how the Bible says it. And this is what I want to kind of hit on the head, because I think this is a lot of us wrestle with this. Verse 4, number 4 in your notes, do not allow marriage to be an idol. This is what he's talking about. And a couple chapters later, he lists all the other idolatries. But he's getting ahead of himself and saying this, don't be so concerned about marriage that you're missing what God is doing in this world. Marriage can be an idol. Marriage can be this thing where we pursue it and we think it is a good thing. Usually idols are good things so that we make God things. So God's given us a gift of marriage, and we take marriage and we put it on this high pedestal and we focus there and we don't realize the whole time that God is doing something way greater, way bigger in your life, that your marriage is a part of, but it's not the be-all, end-all of all things. So we have to be aware of the spiritual reality that we're in, and Paul keeps reminding us of that. Verse 32, he says this, I want you to be free from the concerns of this life. An unmarried man, single people, you can spend your time doing the Lord's work and thinking how to please him. But a married man has to think about his earthly responsibilities and how to please his wife. His interests are divided. Praise God for single people, because you get to spend your entire life focusing on things that please God without divided interests. It's an amazing gift, right? How many of you guys, and you guys, I know plenty, this is a normal thing in marriages. How many married couples in here have had the conversation? What would you do if I died? You ever had that conversation? Usually the wife brings it up, not the stereotype. Usually the wife brings it up because she's wanting to see, would you remarry or am I the only one, right? They're jealous of people, potential people in the future, right? So this is typically what happens. Like, what would you do if I died? I remember me and Meg had that conversation when we like first got married. And her answer was she would move to a monastery, put pictures of me on the wall, write me poems every day, right? She'd miss me every day. I'm just kidding. But it was a good conversation, but it made me realize. I said, you know what I would probably do? I said, it would probably be hard for me to live a normal life without you. And this was before kids, too, we were talking about. I said, I don't know if I could just stay and keep doing the same old thing. I said, I'd probably go to Africa and just give my life to the Lord in missions. And I don't know why I said that, but I'm like, it actually feels like the right answer for some reason. I feel like what Paul's hitting at is there's a deep desire in us, married and unmarried, to serve God with our whole life. And it's going to look different for everybody, but Paul is saying that deep desire to serve the Lord is sometimes hidden by marriage. It's going to be divided in its interest with marriage. Because now I'm called to love my wife like Christ loved the church, which again is a great thing, but it can be a distraction against the deepest desires of our heart, which is to serve and love God. And so Paul's just giving us wisdom here. He's not saying one's right or wrong. He's saying they're both gifts. Both of them are gifts. So a married man has to think about earthly responsibilities and his interests are divided. And same thing with a woman. And then he finishes this way, in the same way, a woman who's no longer married, has never been married, can never be devoted to the Lord and holy in body and in spirit. And so he finishes up this way, a couple more verses. He says this, but a married woman has to think about her earthly responsibilities, verse 34, and how to please her husband. I'm saying this for your benefit, not to place restrictions on you. Paul's very clear. I'm not telling you not to get married or to get married, and thus saith the Lord. He's saying, I want you to think about this. Here's wisdom. If you want to give your whole life to the Lord, marriage might not make sense. Paul's a pragmatist. Pastor Rick has a sister, which is kind of a cool thing. My auntie, the first person I went to Africa with, was unmarried her entire life. And she even adopted. She's like, I don't think that my marriage status has to do with me being a mother as God created me to mother. So she adopted an orphan. She raised her. That's my cousin to this day. And the Lord sent her a man into her life. I think, was it late 50s, early 60s, something like that? Which is unprecedented. Like, we just didn't expect it. We thought, Auntie's going to be celibate her whole life. She's going to be unmarried her whole life. But the Lord has ways of navigating. Some of us will get married, and this is kind of tragic to think about. Some of us get married, and we lose our spouse. And we thought this was going to be a whole life thing, and all of a sudden we're in this season of like, man, what do I do? I feel like this hole, this puka in my spirit. I've lost the love of my life. And what Paul is kind of doing is slowly pointing our eyes back to Jesus, saying no matter if you're married or if you're single, your life is about honoring and serving and loving the Lord, first and foremost. And if we miss that, right, then we're going to be making an idol about having a life of marital status, marital bliss, single bliss, right, bachelor life. But we're going to be pursuing the wrong things. And that's what he's worried about, is the disorder of the Corinthian church is viewing marriage as something other than secondary, which is the last point in your notes, that marriage is always a secondary calling, always a secondary calling. There's a call over your life. There's a destiny. There's something the Lord has wired you for that is greater than whether or not you're married. Marriage typically amplifies the things God has given you in your life. It's a gift that where me and my wife can now do together better than what I can do myself. But also, you single with the Holy Spirit has that same capacity to walk in godly order. So here's the idea. Marriage is always a secondary calling. And he finishes it like this, verse 36. If a man thinks that he is... Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, let's go to verse 34. We'll end here. Verse 34, a man married to a woman has to think about her earthly... We'll end there. Verse 35. So he said, I'm saying this for your benefit, not to place restrictions on you. He says this, I want you to do whatever will help you serve the Lord best with as few distractions as possible. How many times do we go to marriage counseling or get marriage advice, which is, I want you to serve the Lord with as few distractions as possible? It's not normal marriage advice, right? Or single advice. But this is something that we want to pray as a church to become a Pono church, is that single people in the church would feel so valuable and needed in their gifting. For Meg and I, because we're married and we have like a zillion kids, some of our best friends and most important kingdom partnerships are single people. Because you have time to run and grab us groceries. You have time to watch our kids. No, seriously. And you have time. You have all this energy and time that we just feel we're lacking. And on the adverse, those same friends, when holidays roll around and they have no family in town, they come and they're part of our family. So we offer belonging and family, like we hanai them as ohana. And this is the beautiful symbiotic nature of singleness in marriage. And Paul's saying this, whether you're single or married, both gifts work in flow with one another. And so there is nothing less than about someone who is unmarried. And there's not something less than someone who is married, even if it seems like a rough marriage. Sometimes single people look at married people and be like, ooh, I'm glad that's not me, right? So this is real life. There is no better or greater. These are different gifts worth stewarding. Amen? So this is what it's all about. And we're going to stand in a minute, and we're going to pray and just make some declarations over ourselves, over the church, and becoming a Pono church, and that this understanding that this scripture would not go in one ear, out the other, but it would help just transform the way that the Lord is forming us into the image of his son. So would you bow with me as the worship team comes up, and we're just going to pray. Jesus, we thank you so much, God, for what you have been doing. Man, Lord, we just honor you for the stories of everybody here. We honor you, God, that you have been blessing and showing up for people in their singleness. And that in their singleness and in that choice to be celibate and to devote themselves wholly, devoted to you, Father, that there's just been something beautiful formed in their spirit. We thank you, God, for the gift of singleness. We thank you for every single person in this room who has the capacity to give themselves to you in ways that many of us who are married just don't seem to have. We thank you, God, for every married couple. We thank you for every bit of endurance, every little bit of growth, every self-sacrifice that has been shown up in our marriage, Lord, in the light that that has shown to people around us about how you love us. We thank you, God, for that this beautiful thing called marriage. We thank you for the intimacy. God, we bless the sex of every married couple in our church right now, in Jesus' name. We bless the intimacy. We pull down walls, Lord, that is keeping people from interacting and responding intimately to one another. We pray for healing over hurts of the past. God, we just pray that there would just be an addressing of things that are keeping us from fully stewarding the gift that is marriage. Father, help us to see it that way, in marriage not as a burden, but what a joy it is to steward this beautiful life that you've given me in partnership with. Jesus, humble us, Lord, where we need to be humbled. And Father, I pray that you would raise us up to remember that it's never been about us the whole time, but it's about your glory, your kingdom manifested here, impacting the lives of others, bringing others in to know who you are. We pray, God, for those who have unbelieving spouses. Father, we pray that you would continue in perseverance to use them as a light of your gospel to the very closest person to them. Jesus, make conversations more real. Jesus, make that urgency to know you just flourish within these marriages, Lord. I pray, God, for softened hearts. I pray for rattled foundations of those in unbelief. I pray, God, that you would start doing a new work and bringing home in love all the children that you've created. And so, Jesus, we love you. We honor you. We thank you for this word that reminds us of the heavenly order of our marital status. We thank you, Lord, that what you have put together may no man take apart. So, Lord, keep us from those who might be thinking of divorce. Lord, we just keep us, Lord, from wanting to run from something good. Help us to steward it well again. Help us to find reconciliation. And Father, for those who have been divorced or going through divorce, Lord, give us the grace and the mercy to see what this new season might bring about. And so, Jesus, we love you. We honor you. We thank you for this beautiful grace you pour over us. And when we mess up in our relationships, which all of us do, we thank you, God, that you're a God not of condemnation, but of love and grace. We thank you, Lord, that we have no need to fear, but you've given us a spirit of love and power and of a sound mind. And so, Jesus, we honor you this morning. We worship you again in spirit and in truth because you are good, and without you, we have nothing. So it's in Jesus' name that we pray this morning. All God's people said, amen. Amen. Can we give God some love this morning? Would you rise as we just worship?